All right, everybody, let's take a look at what will be needed in order to get Windows set up for doing PHP development. Let's start off by creating a simple PHP script. I'm going to open the text editor that I'm going to be using. In this particular case, my favorite text editor at the moment on Windows is an editor called Brackets. It's actually created by Adobe. It's a free download. I'm sure if you go Google for it, you can track it down if you wanted to be able to use it too. I'm going to go ahead and start a new file here in Brackets. I have a little shortcut set up so I can quickly and easily start a new HTML type document. In this case, I'm actually going to save it as a PHP script, but HTML basic structure for the moment. I'm going to call this a test script. There we go. Test script. All right. And then down here in the body, what I'm going to do is I'm going to put in a set of what are called PHP tags. We'll talk about more of those in another episode. For right now, inside these PHP tags, all I'm going to do is I'm simply going to put in echo, and I'm going to say welcome to PHP and a bunch of exclamation points because I really mean it. I'm going to go ahead and take my file that I've created here and I'm going to save it. I'm just going to go ahead and save it up on my desktop, and I think I will just call it first_page.php. PHP files are always saved with a PHP extension. So I'll go ahead and save that there on my desktop, and now I have a PHP script. Now, the actual writing of this PHP script is obviously not a very difficult thing, not if you've done HTML before. Where this gets interesting, kind of what it is that we need to talk about here, is how do I actually now run this script? What is it I have to do to actually be able to execute it? So now that I have the script written, let's take a look and see what would happen if I just opened it in my web browser. I'm using Google Chrome here. If I go to Google Chrome, I'm going to hit Control O for open. I'm going to go to my desktop and I am going to tell it to open my PHP file that I've created here, first page. And what happens is basically nothing at all shows up. The situation is essentially that Google Chrome, the browser, is able to fundamentally read and understand the file that I've asked it to open, because browsers, of course, understand HTML just fine. But the part that I put in that is the actual PHP code, the part that is supposed to be executed, essentially, is opaque to the browser. The browser has no idea how to actually open or how to actually execute that PHP code. As a matter of fact, here in the browser, if I go to the tools and I tell it to actually show me the source code that the current page is based on, I actually see in there the PHP code itself. The PHP code is not being executed. It's essentially just still sitting there, kind of inert, not running the way that it's actually supposed to. So that's our fundamental problem. What I need to do in order to be able to have the PHP code execute inside the HTML document is I need to have an actual running PHP server. You might refer to it as a compiler, an interpreter, a server, however you want to talk about it. There has to be a PHP component that is actively running the PHP code that's a part of our HTML file here. So that's what we really need to do. In order to get this to work, it's a lot easier on Windows today than it was just a handful of years ago. Classically, what we would have had to do is we would have had to first set up a web server. That web server would then be able to, of course, serve our PHP file here. And then connected to that web server, communicating with it, we would have also had to set up, configure, install a PHP component, a PHP module that would go along with it. We're pretty lucky nowadays, though, because this whole process has actually gotten quite a bit easier, because now if we download, set up, and configure PHP in the proper way, it will actually give us a built-in test server. So essentially, instead of us having to install, configure two different servers, we only actually have to mess with one nowadays. So let's do that. Just about any time you need anything having to do with PHP, where you're going to want to go to get it is to php.net. This is sort of the main clearinghouse website for most everything having to do with PHP. You can see we have a link up here to at the top for the downloads, which is where we'll go. But I also, while we're here, want to point out that this is also the best place to go for PHP documentation. For the moment, though, I am going to go ahead and click on the downloads link. And once I've done that, over on the right side, it lists out binaries. These are essentially pre-compiled versions of PHP that we can use if we don't want to have to compile our own version. If you know how to compile your own version, you're of course welcome to do that. But if you're working on Windows, chances are the easiest path to get this working is just to download pre-compiled binaries. Here we have Windows binaries that are hosted on php.net, which is essentially what I want. That will take me over to windows.php.net, which is sort of the Windows version of the PHP website. And once I'm here, there's again a downloads link up at the top. I'll go ahead and click on that. Once I've gotten to that point, I will then have listed on this page pre-compiled versions of PHP that I can download. At the time that I'm making this video, the current version of PHP that's available is 5.5.13. There is an excellent chance that that will no longer be the current version at the time that you're actually watching this video. But that's okay, because they are very standardized. They follow a certain pattern, so what version we're actually talking about actually doesn't matter that much. What you will want to do at the time that you actually go to download the software is simply go to whatever the newest version is. When you actually do go to the newest version, what you'll see is that there's essentially four different options given, right? These four gray blocks right through here. Each of them starts with VC11. Each of them is listed, well, I should say two of them are listed as being x86. The other two are listed as being x64. So basically the x86 is the 32-bit versions of PHP. The x64 is the 64-bit versions of PHP. Unless you know very specifically what you're doing and you're doing it for a very specific reason, I would ignore the 64-bit version. So really, we just need to concentrate on these first two. Of these first two, one is listed as being non-thread safe. The other is listed as being thread safe. Nothing we're going to be doing, no setup that we're going to try to accomplish, is going to require a non-thread safe version. So it's really this x86 thread safe version that you want to download. So to kind of wrap that up, when you go to download your version, your pre-compiled binaries for PHP on Windows, you want to find the 32-bit version, which will be listed as x86, and the one that says thread safe. Once you find that one, you can click on the link to download the zip file, which will take just a minute here, but maybe with the magic of video, I'll be able to speed that up a bit. Sure enough, there we go. The download is complete. What I can do at that point is then actually go find that download. It should be in my downloads folder. So if I open Windows File Explorer, go to downloads, I should see the zip file I just downloaded listed there. If I then double click on that zip file, it will show me everything that's in it. And essentially what I want to do is I want to take the contents of this file, right? I want to extract it out to a different folder. So I'm actually going to go back to the original file itself. I'm going to right click on it and I'm going to choose extract all. When it asks where I want to extract it to, what I'm going to tell it is to extract it to /PHP. I'll click the extract button then. And there we are. What I've done at that point is on my C drive, I will now have a folder called PHP, and inside that folder is the extracted contents of the zip file that I downloaded, which is exactly what I want. Of all the different files that were extracted here, a few that are most important, well, let's say for the moment the one that is the most important is this one right here, the actual PHP application itself. What I need to be able to do here for the second step is I need to have the ability to actually run this particular file. In order to do that, I can go to my Start menu, and on my Start menu, I can locate the command prompt. I'm just going to type CMD in, right? It finds it for me, and when I hit Enter, it opens up a command prompt. At that point, if I try to run that PHP application, it comes back and it tells me that is not a recognized internal or external command. So we can see in the Finder window that there actually, I'm sorry, not Finder window, in the Windows Explorer window, that there is actually a PHP program out there, but Windows isn't able to find it. The reason for that has to do with these things called paths. The way I can get my path set up so that this will work is, again, on my Start menu, if I go to Computer, right-click and choose Properties. A settings screen will pop up. Let me just adjust the size of that here. Once I'm here in my system settings screen, I can go to Advanced System Settings. I can then click on Environment Variables. And this is where I can actually set up paths. Depending on whether you are an administrator on your computer or not, you may or may not be able to edit the system variables that are listed down at the bottom. So let's just go through this by editing the variables up here at the top. What I'm going to do up here at the top is I'm going to click the New button. I'm going to type Path. And then where it asks for the variable value, I'm going to put in percent path percent semicolon C colon backslash PHP. Now what this is actually going to do is it is basically going to tell Windows that whenever I try to use a program from the command line, the first thing it should do is look at the original path that was set, essentially telling it look in your normal default locations. But then I'm also telling it after you're done looking in those places, also look in this PHP folder. That should then allow it to be able to find the PHP application. So I'll go ahead and click the OK button to pop that path in there. Then I'm going to start clicking the OK buttons to get myself back out of the system preferences. All right. Now again, if I go back and open a command prompt, if I now type PHP, this time I'm going to put a hyphen V for version on the end of it. It got closer to working this time. PHP.exe actually did run. Problem is it's saying that I'm missing an actual component from Windows, a file called msvcr110.dll, which could potentially be a little bit different for you. I'll go ahead and click OK on this, and what I need to do now is I need to go out to the web, find that particular DLL file, and download it. After a quick bit of Googling around, what I found is this particular page on the Microsoft website. Basically, I just Googled for the name of the DLL file that it said that I needed, and here I have found a place where I can go and download a installer that will give me that file. So let me go ahead and download that. All right, I'm going to go ahead and tell it to download the 32-bit version of it, the one that has the x86 on it. I'm going to ignore the x64 version. I'll click Next. There we go. File's downloading, and it looks like that's done. Let me now go back over to my File Explorer window. Go back to Downloads. And here's the file I just downloaded from Microsoft. I'll double-click on it to install it. And we have it. Let's see how things work now. Again, back over at my command prompt, if I try running php-v, hey, look at that, no more error message. Now it comes back and tells me what version of PHP I actually have installed. What that tells me, seeing that message, is that Windows is now recognizing that PHP is installed, right? Which means that I should actually be able to run it. Now, like I mentioned before, PHP nowadays comes with a built-in web server, which is very convenient because we can start that web server and then access our PHP scripts through it. Right? This is nice because not only then are we accessing the files through the web server, but PHP is also there ready to go ahead and run our code, run our PHP code that's embedded in those HTML files. So let me start up a server. Before I actually do start the server, though, what I need to do is I need to navigate here and start the server at the place where my files will actually be, or at least close to it. In this particular case, my file is there on my desktop, so here on the command prompt, I'm going to change directories to my desktop by typing cd space desktop. Cd stands for change directory. At that point, I'm here at my desktop, and if I type dir, I can actually see my file listed, so I know that I'm in the right place. To actually start my PHP server then, I'm going to type php space hyphen capital S for server. Then I'm going to type localhost, meaning start the server on this computer. And then I'm going to type colon 3000. What that's actually going to tell it to do is to start the server and have the server listen on port 3000. The reason for port 3000 is that we essentially want the server to run in a networked sort of way that isn't going to interfere with anything else that might be going on the computer. Sticking the server out and telling it to listen to port 3000 should keep it from messing with anything else. I'll go ahead and hit enter now. And there we go. The server is now running. One thing I want to point out here in this first little bit of output that the server is giving me is that it lists the document root as being, right? And it has a path that ends here with my desktop, essentially where I just changed directories to. That document root is important because it essentially means that our server that we have running here now is going to expect all of our files to be in that location. And if the file isn't in that location, we will actually have to give a path in the browser's address bar in order to tell it where to actually find our file. Let's go ahead and give this a try now. I'm going to pull my browser back up. And in my browser, whereas before I was trying to open the file directly, what I want to try to do now instead is to open the file through my server that's running. So the server is running on localhost 3000, so I'm going to start the address with that. Then I'm going to put in a slash, and I'm going to tell it the name of my file. I believe I called it first_page.php. When I hit the enter key, it finds the file. It executes the file, and unlike before, we're actually now seeing the executed output of the PHP script. Like I did before, if I come back over to my tools and take a look at the source code the browser is basing the current page on, I can see that there's actually no PHP code. The PHP tags that I had typed in and the echo command that I had given are all gone. Because what's happened at this point is that when I accessed my PHP script through the server, the PHP part of it, recognized that there was executable PHP code in it. It ran that code and then put back into the output here the actual output of what the PHP code said to do. So it literally echoed, "Welcome to PHP." Welcome to PHP became a part of the output that then joined all the HTML output. Right? That entire batch of output was then sent here to my browser, and that's what the browser actually shows. So at that point, I have a running PHP script. Before we leave this, one last thing that I wanted to mention, right, again has to do with that document root. Back over on my desktop, if instead of having first page actually sitting directly on my desktop, if I instead had a subfolder, let me create a folder here. I'm going to call it examples. And then I had my PHP page there in that folder. If I go back over to my browser at that point and try to refresh, I get an error at that point telling me it can't find firstpage.php. The reason for that is that document root that I pointed out before. The document root is my desktop, which means that anytime I go to localhost 3000, where it is actually looking on my computer is directly at the desktop. So this address in my browser is saying on the desktop, there should be a file called firstpage.php. And of course, that file isn't there anymore. I just moved it. I can still access that page, right? But what I have to do is be more specific about where it is. If I go and I say that the file is in a folder called examples, right? So localhost colon 3000 slash examples slash firstpage.php, then I'm saying starting at the desktop, which in this case is essentially localhost 3000, go to a folder called examples, and then from there, you should find a page called first page. Right? So being able to do this is nice because it means that as our PHP scripts become larger and more complicated, as we end up having many multiple pages that make up an entire PHP website, we can take those different pages and we can put them, separate them into separate folders in order to help keep everything a little more structured, a little bit more manageable. But it's important to remember, that in order to then be able to access those pages in various different folders, we are going to have to always keep these paths in mind.